Welcome everyone. In this lecture we are going to see for the time division multiple access, that is comparison of TDMA and FDMA, and then for the onboard processing of the TDMA, that is again satellite switch processing we are going to see. So the comparison of uplink power requirements for both the FDMA and TDMA we'll see here with reference to the previous lectures of the TDMA, is that all over what we have seen, and for the FDMA analysis for uplink power and downlink power with frequency division multiple access, we can easily compare here the uplink power for both the FDMA and TDMA. So with frequency division multiple access, the modulated carriers at the input to the satellite are retransmitted from the satellite as combined frequency division multiplexed signal. Each carrier retains its modulation, which may analog or digital. For this comparison, digital modulation will be assumed. The modulation bit rate for each carrier is equal to the input bit rate, and which is adjusted for forward error corrections also. We can also see the situations regarding this in the diagram, where for simplicity the input bit rate is assumed to be the same for each of the earth station, that is RB. The EIRP is also assumed to be the same for each earth station, and with time division multiple access, the uplink bursts which are displayed in the time from one another are retransmitted from the satellite as combined time division multiplex signal. The uplink bit rate is equal to the downlink bit rate in the case, and compression buffers are needed in order to convert the input bit rate RB to the transmitted bit rate RTDMA, because the TDMA earth stations have to transmit at a higher bit rate compared with the FDMA. A higher EIRP is required in FDMA. So we can see here, this is the FDMA network. In the first A diagram we have seen the modulation rate is RB. For the various frequencies, F1, F2, F3 has been assigned to the respective earth stations. And this is the modulation rate bit for the F-F3. This is during the transmission from earth station to the satellite, and this is from the satellite to the earth station. And in B, we can see that this is the TDMA network, where the modulation rate RTDMA has been given. The same frequency has been utilized, but the different time slots has been given and has been sent for the satellite and again to the earth station. So the equations that for carrier to noise ratio we can state as EB by N0 plus R. R is nothing but equal to the bit rate RB for FDMA uplink and RTDMA for TDMA uplink. For a given bit error rate, that is BER, the E by N0 ratio is fixed. Hence, assuming that EB by N0 is the same for the TDMA and FDMA uplinks, an increase in R requires a corresponding increase in carrier to noise ratio. Assuming that the TDMA and FDMA uplinks operate with the same losses and G by T ratios, the increase in carrier to noise ratio can be achieved only through an increase in the earth station EIRP. So therefore EIRP for the TDMA minus EIRP of FDMA is given as the rate of TDMA minus bit rate of FDMA uplink. For the same earth station antenna gain, in each case the decibel increase in earth station transmit power for TDMA compared with FDMA is P of TDMA minus P of FDMA is equal to RTDMA minus RB again. For small satellite business systems, it is desirable to be able to operate with relatively small earth stations, which suggests that FDMA should be the mode of operations. So on the other hand, TDMA permits more efficient use of satellite transponders by eliminating the need for backup. This suggests that it might be worthwhile to operate a hybrid system in which FDMA is the uplink mode of operation, with the individual signals converted to a time division multiplexed format. in the transponder before being amplified by the TWTA. This would allow the transponder to be operated at saturation as in the TDMA. Such a hybrid mode of operation would require the use of a signal processing transponders. So we are here with the onboard signal processing for FDMA and TDMA operations. We will see for smaller stations carrying digital signals at relatively low data rates, there is an advantage to be gained in terms of earth station power requirement by using the FDMA. On the other hand, TDMA signals make more efficient use of the transponder because backup is not required. The CPS, customer premises service, will make up the significant portion of the satellite demand over the decade, that is in the 1990 to 2000, and multiplex digital transmission will be used most likely at the T1 rate. So this bit rate provides the most of the popular services such as voice, data, video conferencing, but specifically which excludes the standard television signals. So customer premises services is an ideal candidate for the FDMA and TDM mode of operation. To operate in this mode requires the use of signal processing transponders, in which the FDMA uplink signals are converted to the TDM format for retransmission of the downlink. The use of signal processing transponders decouples the uplink from the downlink. This is important because it allows the performance of each link to be optimized independently of the other. Number of signal processing methods have been proposed. One conventional approach is, we will see here in the diagram here, the individual uplink carriers at the satellites are selected by frequency filters and detected in the normal manner. The baseband signals are then combined in the baseband processor, where they are converted to a time division multiplexed formats for remodulation onto a downlink carrier. More than one downlink carrier may be provided here, but for simplicity we will use the one. The disadvantage of the conventional approach are those of excessive size, weight and power consumption, since the circuitry must be duplicated for each input carrier. The disadvantages which are associated with processing each carrier separately can be avoided by means of group processing, in which the input FDMA signals are demultiplexed as a group in a single processing circuit. So feasibility of studying are being conducted into the use of digital type group processors, although it would appear that these may require very high speed integrated circuits, and a different approach to the problem of group processing has been also proposed, which make the use of an analog device known as a surface acoustic wave, that is SAW, the Fourier transform. We will see here onboard signal processing for FDM and TDM operation, where the first diagram will show the conventional approach and where each signal will be separately processed, that is input FDMA input is given, these are frequency filters, IF amplifiers, detectors, and then given to the baseband switch, where after that FPSK modulation will be done with the help of downlink carrier, and TDM modulated output we will get here. That is, each signal will be processed individually here, whereas in the next approach we can see the group signaling. Group signaling has been used here. The group signal processor will be used here, and then for detectors, individual detectors will be given. So likewise, this will be the advantages group signaling process. The surface acoustic wave device consists of two electrodes deposited on the surface of a piezoelectric dielectric. An electrical signal applied to the input electrode sets up a surface acoustic wave, which induced a corresponding signal in the output electrode. In effect, the surface acoustic wave device is a coupled circuit in which the coupling mechanism is the surface acoustic wave. because the propagation velocity of the acoustic wave is much lower than that of an electromagnetic wave. The SAW device exhibits useful delay characteristics. In addition, the electrodes are readily shaped to provide a wide range of useful transfer characteristics. These are two features, along with the fact that the device is small, rigid, and passive, make it a powerful signal processing component. Surface acoustic wave device may be used conventionally as delay lines, as band pass or band stop filters, and they are the key component in a unit known as the Fourier transformer. The Fourier transformer, like any other transformer, works with input and output signals which are functions of time. The unique property of the Fourier transformer is that the output signal is a time analog of the frequency spectrum of the input signal. When the input is a group of FDMA carriers and the output in the ideal case is analog of the FDMA frequency spectrum. This allows the FDMA signal to be demultiplexed in real time by means of commutator switch, which eliminates the need for separate frequency filters. Once the signal have been separated, the original modulated carrier waveforms is recovered through the use of surface acoustic wave inverse Fourier transforms. In practical transformers, continuous operation is achieved by repetitive cycling of the transformation process. As a result, the output is periodic and observation interval has chosen to be desired spectral interval. Also, the periodic interval over which the transformation takes place results in a broadening of the output pulses, which represents the FDMA spectra. Repetitive operation of the Fourier transformer at a rate equal to the data bit rate will produce a suitable repetitive output. The relative positions of the output pulses will remain unchanged, fixed by the frequencies of the FDMA carriers. The PSK modulation on the individual FDMA carriers appears in the phase of the carriers within each output pulse. Thus, the FDMA carriers have been converted to a pulse TDM signal. Further signal processing is required before this can be retransmitted as a TDM signal. So, in the next diagram, we can see the output obtained from a practical Fourier transformer for various input signals. So here is the prototype chip transformation of the 7 successive CW continuous wave input signals and 3 simultaneous input signals, which will including CW and pulsed RF of 200 nanoseconds per division has been given. So this is the CW input frequency given here with the 150 Hz. And in the B section, 3 simultaneous input signals are given, 125 MHz, 150 MHz and 175 MHz, whereas these are continuously given over here, for 120, 130, 150 continuously has been transformed. So for the TDMA, we will see the satellite switched TDMA. This is the most efficient utilization of the satellite in the geostationary orbit. Can be achieved through the use of antenna spot beams. The use of spot beams is also referred to as space division multiplexing. Further improvement can be realized by switching the antenna interconnections in synchronism with the TDMA frame rate. This being known as the satellite switched TDMA. That is, we know that the spot beams, how it will work is that spot beam antenna will cover a specific area on the surface of Earth. With the same idealization, now we will going to see the satellite switch TDMA, that is the interconnections in synchronism with the TDMA frame rate that we are going to see. The simplified form of the SS or satellite switch TDMA concepts we will see here. 3 antenna beams are used and each beam serving 2 earth stations, and a 3x3 satellite switch matrix is given here. So this is the key component that permits the antenna interconnections to be made on a switched basis. A switch mode is a connectivity arrangement here with 3 beams 6 modes would be required for full interconnectivity. And in general, with n beams, n factorial modes are required for full interconnectivity. Full interconnectivity means that the signals carried in each beam are transferred to each of the other beams at some time in the switching sequence. This include the loopback connections where signals are returned along the same beam, enabling intercommunications between the stations within a beam. So we can see here, this is the satellite switching of the three spot beams, and connectivities has been given here for inputs A, B, C. These are different modes has been given, M1, mode 1, 2, 3 up to 6, where these are the connectivities mode. And from the distribution control, 3x3 switch matrix has been given. Here is the telemetry and control for the earth station and satellite. These are the three spot beam antennas of the satellites, which will cover A1, A2, beam A. B will cover B1 and B2 earth stations, and respectively for the C. So of course, the uplink and downlink microwave frequencies are different, we know, because of the beam isolation. One frequency can be used for all uplinks and a different frequency for all downlinks. So as in this, as we are using the beam antennas, one single frequency can be used for all uplinks and all downlinks. To simplify the satellite switch design, the switching is carried out at the intermediate frequency that is common to uplinks and downlinks, and the basic block diagram for this 3x3 switch matrix we can see here. The mode pattern is a repetitive sequence of the satellite switch mode, also referred to as the satellite switch TDMA frame. Successive satellite switch TDMA frames need to be identical since there is some redundancy between the modes. So this is the switch matrix has been given here, 3x3 switch matrix. For KU band, we will see that 14 GHz frequency has been given to the receiver, RX, and these are the transmitter antennas. So with this switch matrix, any receiving antenna can be connected to the any other transmitting antenna, where we are downlink frequencies 12 GHz. This may be at the satellite. So as we have seen for the beam antennas, a beam A interconnects in the figure, initial figure, that three different beam antennas has been given for satellite. Beam A interconnects with the beam B in mode 3 and 5. We'll see here. Beam A will interconnect to beam B in the mode 3 and 5. Here is A, B, and B has been given here. A can interconnect with B in mode 3 and 5. Respectively, there is B will interconnect to A again in 3 and 4. And so on. So thus not all modes need to be transmitted during each satellite switch TDMA frame. Only 3 and 5 modes has been transmitted. However, for full interconnectivity, that is for all mode has to be accessible, mode pattern must contain all modes. All stations within a beam receive all the TDMA frames transmitted in the downlink beam. Each frame is a normal TDMA frame consisting of bust addressed to different stations. As mentioned here, the successive frames may originate from different transmitting stations and therefore have different bust formats. The receiving station in a beam recovers the bust addressed to it in each frame. The two basic type of switch matrix are the crossbar matrix and rearrangeable network. The crossbar matrix is easily configured for the broadcast mode, in which one station transmits to all stations. In broadcast mode with the rearrangeable network type switch, switch is more complex, and this can be a deciding factor in favor of the crossbar matrix. The 3x3 crossbar matrix, as we have already seen one of the 3x3 crossbar matrix there, the input B connected in the broadcast mode. The switching elements may be ferrite, diodes or transistors. We'll see in the next diagram this 3x3 cross markets. So we can say that the input pin B where it will get connected. The dual gate field effect transistors appear to offer significant advantages over other types and consider most promising technology. So in this we can see that this is the 3x3 crossbar matrix switch showing B connected in the broadcast mode. So this is the inputs and these are the outputs. B will be connected here to this A, B as well as C. Whereas A is also connected to, has been given connections, but these switches are open. Only B will be connected here for all the three A, B, C destinations. So the another 3x3 matrix switch which we will see here may be used to reroute the traffic. Each of the ground stations, there are the other three. First we will see the diagram. So this is the diagram where the stations has been given U, V, W, and different beams are given, that beam X, beam Y, beam Z are given here, and this is the switch control will be given, and frames are satellite 3x3 switch matrix has been given. So respectively these are the earth stations U, V, W, and these are the beams. So the switch matrix may be used to reroute traffic, and each of the ground stations U, V, W accesses a separate antenna on the satellite and carries traffic destined for the downlink beams X, Y, Z. That will carry the traffic which will be destined for the different beams. The switch is controlled from a ground control station, and the switching sequence for the frame labeled with script 1 as shown here, the lower part of the figure that we can see. The schematic for 4x4 matrix switch is also used, and that is arrangement is derived from the crossbar matrix. It permits broadcast mode operation but does not allow more than one input to be connected to one output. Means the another switch matrix has been also given, and that will permit the broadcast mode of operation where it will not allow more than one input to be connected to one output. For the 3x3 matrix that we are going to see is where the frame are labeled with subscripts as 1, 2, 3. So in this diagram, this is the input we have seen here, where frames are labeled as ZU1, YU1, XU1, ZU1. Respectively, this is the frame 1 and these are the outputs. This is again input frame 2, and respectively these are the output, again like the switch matrix, that each earth station having the separate antenna and different frames has been given here, that will given to the switch matrix. This is the receiving antenna of the matrix, and with the help of this 3x3 switch matrix, any earth station, that is U, V, W ground stations, can communicate to the destined beams X, Y, Z. So this is the 4x4 switch matrix, and this is the redundant ESP4T switch element, where these are the RF input frames where diodes are used here and some capacitors are also used here. So the 4-way dividers are given for SP4T output will be given here. These are 4 inputs, and into that this is the circuit diagram of redundant SP4 output. SP4 outputs circuit switch element. So the diodes are used as switching element, and diode quad are used which provide the redundancy against the diode failure. Because if one of the diode will fail, the another will take place. Will get replaced with it. It is clear that the satellite switch TDMA adds to the complexity of the onboard equipment and to the synchronization requirements. So the baseband processors are considered in more detail here, and we know that for the switched satellite switched TDMA, one advantage that TDMA has when we used with the baseband processing transponder, satellite switch TDMA is used, and instead of using the single antenna beam, we have maintained the continuous communication with the entire coverage zone. Okay, so in next lecture we'll see the another multiplexing mode, that is the code division multiple access. So this is all over about the TDMA. We'll see next lecture the CDMA, code division multiple access. Thank you.